Brewing. Welcome back to part three of Scrap Mechanic, or specifically part three of Let's Replicate Molecular Mechanical Computing Systems with Merkle, with myself, Brian Balson Stanton, and the paper that we're replicating is by Merkle, Freitas, Hogg, Moore, Moses, and Riley. This time my microphone is working. And it says I am live. I need to figure out a better way of doing the Twitter thing. And I think okay, so I told it to announce Twitter. It failed. Scientifically replicated, blah, 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 blah. All right, so that's on Twitter. Now, I'm going to close Twitter there, and I'm just going to use my phone. Just going to use my phone because the default clients are stupid. All right. Phone volume, on the other hand, is alarms only. All right, so that's going so professional, this is not. But we've got chat, we've got our stream that we can see via Google. We are happily our only viewer. Wait, no, that's not true. And, oh, I know I forgot something, and that was starting Scrap Mechanic, because why would you ever need to start the... Oh, and it's 11:32, which means I need to depress the plunger on my coffee in 4 minutes. And, of course, I just obscured the clock. Right. Ooh, and chat is live. Hello, 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 hello. Hi, Lightbringer. How are you? So yes, this is part three. Considering what a fiasco recording was last time, and given that we okay. Everything is fine. I just started in an unusual position. Fine. Everything is fine. So, given that we have an audience, I should probably put in my headphones so that I can hear what's going on. Sorry for jostling the mic. I've got a lovely H2N Zoom on a tiny little tripod. So yes, the delay isn't too bad. You know what I need to do? I need to make this be all the way over here so that it's in my peripheral vision. So that I can see the fact that I'm... Wait, three people are watching. Highly suspicious. Highly suspicious. Anyways. Scroll this over. Excellent. Now I can see chat out of my peripheral vision. Okay, so given that we actually have a audience, let me sum up. Wait, no, it's too long. Is that the line? Oh, what is the line? Let me explain. No, it's too long. Let me sum up. What our enterprise is doing is trying to replicate Alt-Tab Merkle's Molecular Mechanical Computing Systems in Scrap Mechanic. What I did in episode one was implement this rotary links block and started on the lock. In episode two, I continued on the lock, got frustrated at its size, and made a smaller one. So, the control, because all experiments and all replications need a control, is a simple XOR gate made in Scrap Mechanic. So, basic spider webbing, we've got a rotator, we've got a truth table, we've got a sensor. If one of the switches is on, it rotates. If both the switches are on, it rotates out. Standard XOR stuff. we have the basic demonstration of the four-bar latch, and the four-bar latch goes like so. Is the volume of the microphone good? And is the volume of the game good? So this is a basic thing. Now, the one problem with this, and I didn't catch this until much later, is that it's goes from 1 to negative 1, and therefore needs a stop. So basically, this gate is on, and yes, so this isn't going to work because gravity pulls it down. So this is my first gate, and it works, right? This is the recenter switch. This is the equivalent to an input, and I'm going to show you the input. So basically, when this is pushed forward, and I don't know why they just rotated this up. This is not a very good... Okay, so the way they're doing this is that they're showing that this is rotating around a point and then pushing this linkage forward. The desk noises are loud relative to everything. Game noises are inconsequential. Yeah. Unfortunately, I've got a mechanical DOS keyboard, and I have no idea how to reduce my desk noises. So I have an extra super clicky keyboard, which is normally a joy to work with. Suggestions aren't appreciated. So I've got a lovely pop filter. I can get my fluffier pop filter. I mean, I can poke at this microphone, mic side level, turn off side level. Oops. And so this is going to be hugely loud. That should... Nope. It's still picking up keyboard. Anyways, sorry about the keyboard noises. I don't know how to fix them. Anyways, here is the first gate I built. Or rather, the first bit I built. And so you can see that everything is organic from this post right here. It grows out and around. And so... to prove this, if this side is set at zero, does the mic have an isolating mount? No, it doesn't. Unfortunately, I'm recording from my office, where I do normal work, and I don't have a recording set up. We're doing some stuff with, I'm not actually sure an isolating mount would help. It's the mouse too, so it's not coming in for the tripod. Okay. No, that's a good point, because the... Okay. I mean, I can put it on a rubber base, which is my coffee. How is that? Is the mouse movement coming through there? Well, okay, obviously we come through there because I just tapped it. And of course the mouse is on just the pure desk. Oh, so professional, I'm not. There, now the mouse is on my coffee cloth. Coffee! That's what I'm missing. Oh, dearie me. So, as we can see... this is... whatever. As we can see, this is at 1, right? So this is advanced enough to trigger the sensor. Yep. And this is at 0. And so therefore, if we try to advance this, this is in fact so strong, because the system is isolated, that this retreats to 0. So this is at 1 and this is at 0. If we try to hit this... it returns to 0. And it never advances far enough to activate the of 1. Oh, okay. Well, coffee is good for an amazing amount of things. Because yes, I stood the mic's tripod on my Rubbermaid container, so it's got a bouncy lid, and coffee's amazing. It does all the things. Because clearly the coffee beans are absorbing the noise, right? That's just logic. No? Logic doesn't work that way? But coffee solves everything. Anyways, so this construction right here, as abysmal as it is, proves that their basic latch system... Large cup of coffee. But poured away from the mic, because I'm trying to spare an actual audience's ears. And there are three people watching. Oh my god. Anyways, so this demonstrates that their basic limiter, right? The basic, if one side is one, the other side cannot be one. So that is the fundamental requisite of figure six, is possible, right? Because this side is at one, and because this side is actively being forced forward, this side cannot be at one. See? And it never gets the of this side being at one. So, it works. On the other hand, this monstrosity is in fact a monstrosity. I'm not building this again. So, I decided that given that one of these worked, I could optimize. So the first optimization I did was with a 7-bar length, and it's amazing. It actually works and is simple and is... So, that's horrible. Actually, that's not bad. All right, so this is the much simplified version that I spent yesterday working on last evening. Ask me about automated typesetting environments. I dare you. So this is the same mechanism, but because it's much smaller, so the bottom's just a huge knot. So it works, and you can see that this is at one, and if I advance this to one, it does the same linkage, right? It requires that only one of the gates be at one. And the fundamental innovation... Oh, excellent. So the fundamental thing that I realized was the length of these sidebars is in fact critical. These must be exactly the same as the center mount bar, because that latches the center bar. And so at 7, I then went, wait, hold on, why not 3? And then it was 9:30 and I had to catch the bus home. So that is where I am at. And so today I'm going to get this down to 3 and see if that works, and then I'm going to build this. Any questions? Hot. Coffee is too hot. Okay, you shouldn't push them with controllers. Explain. Because part of that is these two system rules that we're going to need to deal with. But when you say shouldn't push them with controllers, do you mean like this? Or do you mean the... whole system, because the point of the whole system is that you don't need controllers, and there's a better way to do it than this that I had thought about. Controllers are powerful enough to break through Judean bearings. Oh, that's just a function of making sure that you set the lengths correctly. But yes. Basically, the controller should only be on the linear bearings. So I would never want a controller there. I think that's what you're talking about. The controller should always be external to the system. And this is not external to the system, but it's pushing the system in the way that the system should be pushed. But yes, it is. The controllers are absolutely a delicate piece of the puzzle. Oh, the other thing I discovered yesterday was rotary friction. Rotary friction is not high enough to matter. Or sorry, sliding friction isn't high enough to matter. So if we push this out more. Oh yeah. that I absolutely believe. So hopefully by pushing things with a balance. Yeah, that's also why I only put a controller on one side. The important thing with the balance is that the force always has somewhere to go, right? That these knots aren't amazing. And I certainly wouldn't recommend the adoption of these mechanisms until loops exist. Hopefully loops exist. But, so yes, the other thing I was playing with yesterday was rotary friction. Basically, does wood in this game, sliding against wood, separated by a bearing, have any difference? So this is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Basically, I was exploring whether or not I needed to lift them off the wood. And the conclusion I came to was, no, not really. They're basically fine. But we can demonstrate this, and replication is always important. So, more surface area touching, less surface area touching. And we give it, okay, I can't. Let's see, there we go. So, we go, click. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 6. Okay, so 6 turns with no touching, and 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 5.5 turns with touching. Okay, so as the system grows, it does seem to matter. Previous, they were both getting a before 6. On the other hand, this is so annoying. But basically, what this tells us, contrary to what I learned yesterday, was that we should be mindful of sliding friction where we can be. Certainly in any meaningful system. So, this is a little tiny one. Little tiny one. So, with a 3-bar linkage, or a 3-distance linkage, and T's. It's the plan, at least. 4 people are watching. This is a conspiracy. 2, 3, is that right? 1, 2, 3, yep, that's right. 2, 3, 2, 3, yep. And then go up, and so this T-bar setup is so much better than the knots and knots is wearing you head with your hammer than the restriction. Yeah, that is absolute Lightbringer. Where I hit it with my hammer versus friction, that's what I subscribed the earlier thing to. If you can think of a better replication strategy where we can demonstrate that, I would be delighted. Because that's my hypothesis as well. And the reason why I'm calling this series a Let's Replicate is I quite legitimately think that I can get a paper out of this, right? This is my engineering log. And so I can demonstrate with an infinity of pictures my build process and my reasoning. And I think that that would be a quite nice 2-3 contribution to the field. So, yay, research on the weekends. I was about to say you can take the academic out of academia, except for the fact that I'm quite literally sitting in my office at university doing this. So you can't, in fact, take the academic out of academia. They just go right back. That was a joke. Not really. Okay, and then we knot this. And so my other question to you, Lightbringer, is can you think of any more efficient means of knotting? Like, this works, and it works to a point that's quite impressive. Also, thank you for the retweet. Okay. Yep. 2-3. Move center of mass this way. Blink. You had one of... So you say that in one of your episodes you had thrusters spinning a beam next to a thing that can free spin, and it was causing no motion. Okay, well, but that's not quite what I was testing, right? So you're testing, is there transmission of momentum due to friction? Which is different than, is there a decrease of momentum due to friction? Because I would be shocked if there was transmission of momentum due to friction, just because those calculations are, a whole bunch of no fun at all. No, they're basically just a whole bunch of no fun at all for things that people won't work. What I'm testing is, given the paucity of our input sources, does that gap right there exist? Because I want to know if this slows down, not whether it transmits energy. Now, intuitively, according to our expectations of the way it works, obviously if something's slowing down, it's transferring energy, and some of that energy is lost to heat, and some of that momentum is imparted. Your Newton's cradle video, which please link in chat for whomever else is watching. It's so weird that other people are watching. Need to make sure that I'm doing my knots correctly and not incorrectly. Okay, I'm sorry for the knot puns, but I can't help it. I can't help it. I don't not have a weakness for them. You can do so many fun things with knot puns. So, Lightbringer, did my discussion? Do you understand that I was looking at something slightly different? Basically, given a fixed energy input, how many times does it spin? Do buttons depress for a specific amount of time? It won't accept links. Really? Harumph. Then I shall simply have to accept it for them. Because harumph. Harumph, I say. Harumph. Can I... No. Help. It won't accept links. Can I... Okay. Report, block user, put you... Set user as moderator. Excellent. You try. Now that you're a mod. Um... Wow. There we are. Copy. Click. Buttons are not a fixed length input. That's annoying. Ah, perfect. You've done it. So yes, absolutely watch his Newton's Cradle stream, whomever else is watching. I mean, I would say that this is sufficiently persuasive that I don't think I need to investigate this more. Like, there's... I would have expected much more spinning, sliding friction here than here. And because they... Because we can plausibly explain this as where does the hammer hit, I'm not sure we need to investigate this more. But I will if you think that that's warranted. Oh dear. All right. Click and click and click. Is moot because there's no knot here. It's not happening. Sorry. Oops. Click. So, this is where we're at. So, theoretically, this should work. We've got a stop here. And the other thing I've learned is stops. Fantastic. So, stops should be at the midpoint of the beams, mainly because we're doing stuff with the endpoints, and more to the point, the endpoints should actually be hittable. So they should stick out. Except, it's not the right trousers, Gromit. Hypothesis. This system, using three-bar links, should behave with the same locking nuance as the five-bar links. As the five-bar links. So, or five-block links. Welp. Oh. Well, that's different. Okay, well, I think one of the things that told me was that my knots were wrong. So a critical thing about this, right, is that these points are one block beyond. Yeah, wasn't it? you're telling me clipping physics is fun. Oh, that's so good coffee. That this point is that the anchored rotator blocks are beyond the rotation point of here. And that's precisely to avoid this sort of thing, right? Because this anchor point... Oh, I'm gonna have to rebuild the whole thing. Poop. I mean, I can put artificial stops on, but that's not the... Because these are all at the same angle, I don't believe that it would that the artificial stop would even work. So that goes forward. Right. And this can go. Okay. Right. So if we want this to be naturally stopped, then yeah, so the internal geometry must prevent it. I wish there was a flood fill. That would be so useful. Alright, so this failed. You know what? This is small enough, and I'm going to have to rebuild it again, so that just... no. Okay. So what do we do first? The first thing I think we'd want to do is lay out the base. Just like that. So we have the base. Okay, so objective. We have a... So do we think that a 5-bar middle rotator with 2 anchored 3 bars, would that work? Because if we can get it down to this size, this is quite buildable. So I think that this is absolutely worth the effort before moving further on. So we start by having this come up 2, 1, 2, 2, 3. Okay, so what I'm saying is that a 5 center bar, but everything else is the same. 2, 3, 1, 2. Yep. So we go 1. Nope. 1, not 1, 2. And that goes 2, 3, 4, 5. That's 1, 2. And rotator. So another... Correct. So my hypothesis is that the leg length being the same is important, but also that this where the anchored outer joints are below the point of rotation of the locking bar, that's, I would say, more important than leg length. And so I'm not sure I am convinced that the middle bar leg length being the same as these is as important as the relative geometry of these. They have a different arc than the others. Yes, it would, wouldn't it? Okay. So that means if we want this to be 3, but also inset. Yes, and because it has a different arc, then it has different rotational position. Yeah. So So you assert, Lightbringer, that that's not going to work, and that does match with my intuitions. So if we go 1, 2, 3. So do we think this? So these are all 3, but that's inset. You think that the leg length is mandatory and what I'm looking at is as well. Yeah. So if this was a loop, then I could do that effectively, right? That because they emerge from the same center point, but they have independent bearings, it doesn't matter. It's still an anchored center point. But in order to do that here, 2, 3. No. This works because nothing says that the center point needs to be anchored at the center point, simply that it must emerge as if it was anchored from the center point. Or specifically, that it must rotate as if it was anchored from the center point. This is something of an abomination. I'm not sure I approve. I think this is getting too complex for not enough payout. Yeah, because then this goes up, and it's just, it's very visually confusing. Not a fan. All right, so I think it's this system that we're going to stick with the fives, because it demonstrably works. It is a tiny abomination. And, you know, I mean, we are talking about remaking Stevenson's Diamond Age eventually, and that these tiny abominations will occasionally be a thing. So this is, I think, an avenue for optimization when space is on the line. But I don't think that this is appropriate for demonstrating the balance. That is so good coffee. Bay Coffee in Sydney roasts the most wonderful coffee. All right. So we have this. This is what we're going to go with. Objective is, again, because we have N viewers from this paper, from Merkle and Freitas' paper, we want to make this. And so what I learned about this, just thinking through it last night, is that when they're talking about anchored and not anchored bearings, they really mean it. So when this rotates around and goes forward, these three must be able to be free so that it basically pushes in one direction or the other. And then we get to investigate clocks. Yay! 4 people are watching. Inconceivable. I do not think that word means what you think it means. All right, so we are making the base. This thing. Should I clean up my failed experiments? I don't think I should, because failures are important. But what I should do is move them elsewhere. And I think one of the neat parts about this is there's no lag because there isn't complicated webbing in all of those things. It's just they sit here, right? So I'm not feeling lag, and this is just a decent work computer, but nothing astonishing. And this The implications of this, I think, are one of the reasons why I was so interested in this in context of scrap mechanic, because unlike the complex spiderwebbing complexes isn't really a thing, but this is still pretty fiddly. Because this system needs basically one controller per subgate component, this scales abysmally, right? If you wanted to do more logic, it just scales and it's horrible. Whereas I think even though this has a much higher initial cost, and will have a lower initial cost when they're loops. And I say when in just hoping, basically. Hoping against hope. I think that there's real promise for lag. Alright, so here's our system. We need, this is 5 put placards with version numbers and descriptions near the failures. Hi, Mikhail. I don't think there are placards, but that is a good point. We should have an evolutionary history. And I can count in binary, so it's all good. Because of course I count in binary. What are you talking about? So, how do we want to signal ones and zeros? Glass block? When did they put in glass blocks? I don't see anyone playing with glass blocks. Oh, and I should be using metal. Right. No. Glass. Alright, so how do we want to indicate ones and zeros? How about with literal bars and zeros? Does that work? So, this is 1. This is, so this is 1, this is 2, this empty space here is 3. It's brand new. Huh. Did they do anything else in whatever update that I heard about? Or that I didn't hear about? Right. So it's just something random. So that's 100. So good call, Mikhail, on numbering experiments. Because that totally makes sense to everyone, because of course you count in binary. Why wouldn't you count in binary? All right. So, before we were so accurately interrupted, this is going to be 5, 6, 8x7 by 7. So one of these gates is 8x7 by 2. And 8x7 by... So... 8... Balance looks like it needs to be centered, which means it needs to be odd. So we're going to go with 5. 8, 8, 5, 21. Eight, is that right? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. Nope, shit. 1, 2, 3, 4. 3, 3, 1, 2, 3, 3, 6, 9, 12, 15, 16. And then 5. 2, 3, 4, 5. Yep. So that's 3, 6, 9, 12, 15, 18. Because I cannot count, yes, it is indeed 21. So then we're just going to make this workspace 21 by 21. That's not right at all. 3, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay, my brain's not working. How many white bits? 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. Good job! Now, I'm going to leave the center hollow. Because I think that that's going to be important. Because I kept having problems with the center falling on me. And it holding in way too well. So, having good measurements is important. Okay. So, we need to make, and the other component of this is organic growth. Everything must grow from a single fixed point. So let's go back to experiment 3, 1, 1. And it is... five in, two up. Yes. So, 1, 2, 2, 3, 4, 5. And then I always do 2 up, and it seems to work. So, first bar, and then we'll go back to wood. 2, 3, 4, 5. But yes, so my question is, do people have a preference for coloring in terms of being able to tell distance and separate pieces? Six, seven. Black. you color code functions and distances when working technically. So, is my methodology compatible? Or is there a better way? Because I'm definitely doing the similar thing. I'm just 2, 3. I'm wondering about the specific methodology of coloring 2, 3. Is an alpha by one error. And yes, one thing I've definitely learned is getting this proportion is insanely critical. Yeah, it does the job. I agree. 2, 3, 4, 5. Yep. So that these are all the same length and that this is not in the same plane. Now, this 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 2, 3. Oh, I did this wrong. That's fine. The balance is going to be on this side. Because it shouldn't matter. 2, 3. Fail, 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 fail. Practice is definitely helping. Do I happen to know how they plan to avoid gravity issues with the orientation of their tiny machines, or are they tiny for it to not matter? So they don't actually talk about engineering them. Their paper is very theoretical, and that's very much why I'm doing this, because there is something of an implementation challenge. But I'm going to say that the force due to linear The force due to the linear bearings is actually going to be far greater than the force due to gravity. And because there are no free bearings in the system, right, that everything is either linked up to an input or a balance or a prior input, that I don't think gravity matters when all of your inputs are fixed. Right? There's very low mass to this, which means that the force that the inputs are fighting is going to be very low. Counteracting is going to be very low. So my guess is that they do it in an evacuated chamber, very, very much like the Rod Logic in Stevenson. Although of interesting note, they won't have the same heat issues as Diamond Age, right? So one of the big things about Diamond Age is that microscopic chunks of ice are necessary to cool. And this paper is so awesome that they talk about the major energy expenditure of the system being erasing bits. And I really cannot speak to the physics of that. I looked at that part of the paper and went, huh, fascinating. And then went back to this. But I'm pretty sure that gravity doesn't matter, and I'm pretty sure that the need for microscopic chunks of ice a la Diamond Age also doesn't matter. So that they can do this in evacuated holes. They don't have Brownian motion from air jostling, and the force due to gravity is so slight because this is nano-sized diamondoid that whatever you're using to actuate these locks will be sufficient. So that's my hypothesis. I mean, the other obvious solution to this is you just have 4 or 5 computers. Yeah, isn't it amazing that Their fundamental issue is, okay, so limits of computing efficiency. I love that they can put this into their paper and that it's an issue, right? For decades, it has been known that the only true limits on computational efficiency are those posed by the need to expend energy to erase data. It is not actually computation per se that requires energy. The efficiency there is limited only by device design. Computation can theoretically require zero energy. It is the erasure of data, which is absolutely implied by entropy, as Shannon or thermal, right? That it is the decrease of state that is entropy, right? But most logical operations will expend a minimum of about 4 to the negative 21st joules. What? Anyways, so yes, I would basically say that this is small enough and efficient enough that they do a space shuttle approach with multiple computers at multiple orientations and only act if they agree. Because why build one for one when you can build two for twice the price, right? When we're talking about nanofab, price doesn't matter. And if they're running in evacuated holes with motors strong enough to actuate the whole system, gravity won't matter. Bending will matter. And I'm not nearly as sanguine as they are about rigidity. Like, they're really, really my kingdom for loops. Does this look right? I think this looks right. I'm so glad I've simplified it down from version 2. Yeah. This looks right. So now we just have our anchors. Again, they're the experts in this. I think their confidence in rigid bonds of diamond is well placed. Like, we have double-walled carbon nanotubes. Confidence is a slow and insidious killer. Yes, yes. Very much. Is this right? Yes, it is. To be honest, I haven't looked at the molecular nanofab situation in quite some time. One of my graduate classes was in this. One of my graduate classes was in everything. Half of my master's degree was in independent studies. It was a great time. Yeah, I'm an academic. It shows. But was this? No, it wasn't a master's. It was an undergrad. As an undergrad, I took a master's course because I was bored. And so that's the last time when I really looked at nanotech and molecular fabs, right? So I don't know where the state of the art is in terms of rigidity. I suspected I was, insofar as your scrap mechanic series is looking at science, the science of scrap mechanic. I suspect that. Unless you're... Ooh! Music composition and in stats! Fascinating! So yes, given that I have an audience, I might as well talk about who I am. I did my BS and my MS in information technology, and I did my PhD in the philosophy of data. So specifically, how different people understand the nature of data, and there's some striking evidence, and so this is XY, right? So this is how do normal people think, not just me. But there's some striking evidence for three different philosophies of data that are different enough to really create miscommunications. And since I brought it up, there's data as recorded subjective observations. So data is a fundamentally semiotic exercise. And so because data is recorded observations, even if those observations are mediated by computer, it's fundamentally subjective. And so people recording data tend to use data is in that mode. So data is subjective recorded observations. Then there's data as objective measurements. Data are, and objective measurements almost inevitably are data are, folks. So they do data are revealed patterns from stuff in the universe. And then there's a last category that data is encoded human communications, and all the rest of the shit that we're talking about is information. So, does this work? Huh. Yeah, that's visibly at one, and therefore this... Oh, look at that! It's locked! And then you hit it again, and it compels the other... It works! It's a replicable design! It works, it works, it works, it works, it works, it works, it works! I get excited by the smallest things. So, yeah. I'm not a computer engineer. I'm... Much of the circuitry that I'm poking about here, I last did when I was a freshman in 2001. Still, I remember the class. I remember most of my classes. I don't get how normal people don't remember the classes. Why do you bother taking them? But yeah, I think that that's a persuasive thing that it works. That sets to 0, 0. That's forward. That's forward. That cannot be forward. Yeah. And, like, the cool thing about this is actually simple enough to build, right? That this is a design that actually works and is simple enough to build. Neato. All right, so we need okay, so why did you have to go there? Why, oh why didn't I take I'm encroaching. All right, so just make a tail. Good. So the next objective is to make the balance. Yes? Because the linear actuator that I'm thinking of is actually going to be a paddle. Because the point of contact on this rod needs to rotate. And I think the paddle will be least susceptible to crazy bearing physics as this one showed us. I built this thing so wrong. But... I positioned this thing so incorrectly. All right, so we have this joint. What are we doing? We are... So this is where they're talking about rotary joint using atomic bonds. This is... They're showing off, right? Friction in single bond rotary joints. Really? Show-offs. Just show-offs. Oh, check out this animation. This animation is so cool. Yeah. Trombones. All right, so... That comes back out along this shaft. 2, 3, 4. Click. 1. Nope. 2, 3, 4, 5. They did have to show, like, I absolutely agree that they had to demonstrate
that their designs were basically zero because their claims are a little bit, how do you say, impressive? How should I color this junk? I think I'm going to color it mauve. Just so that it's very clear that it's not part of the thing. So, I mean, the idea of this balance, and I think one of the biggest, you know what I can do? I can remove my spoon, I know, right, from my coffee mug, and then it doesn't slide. Wow. I am so smart. So smart. S-M-U-R-T. Work is pinging me. Nope. Nope, 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 nope. No pretty doodlies. Alright. So, click and click. And then this is 212. Yep. S-M-R-T. Wow, I think it can be safely said that my ability to plan out designs isn't is no ability. Dear. So, should I have background music on this thing? I don't think I should, but I don't know. Halt. So that's off by one. These are all five. We can prove that they're five. We should prove that they're five. If we don't prove that they're five, then we just have to redo our work later. As I have learned, always prove your lengths, always prove your lengths, always prove your lengths. I'm going to use a grant application for a mousepad. Oh, that would be really cool if you could... So you compose and record it yourself. So you're doing music composition, you said. Like, what kind of music are we talking about? Nominations for this. Do not spill coffee on the grant application, but use it as a mouse mat. No. That's not going to work. Let's do it like this. Much better. Can you hear the mouse? Well, obviously you can't because I'm not moving it. Can you hear it now? Yes. And I mean, honestly, looking at some of the circuitry designs that this game has spawned, I don't think that this is too objectionable. Objectionable. Two. Three. Little papery, but fine. Yeah, I was just getting frustrated using cloth because it wasn't anchored appropriately. So, if you assert that it is fine, then I will agree that everything is fine. Two, three, four, Yeah, this is a design that isn't horribly fiddly. Oh, cool. I didn't know you composed it yourself. That's really neat. Super neat. Super hot. Neat. So, two master's degrees. Are you planning to. Two master's degrees in composition and statistics. Jazz, you play inside it on London Nets. Neat. Neat, neat, neat. So is one for fun and the other for work, or do you plan to tie them together? Like a musical notation for stats. Nice, man. The fact that you're performing, recording, mixing, and mastering in-house of your own stuff. My congratulations and clank. No, that's not how it goes. My congratulations to you. It feels so weird to be ignoring work messages. That is not a good statement. It's Saturday morning, afternoon. Well, that's not a big research goal at all. Artificial creativity. Who isn't doing artificial? Jesus. Artificial creativity. All right. So of course that means one, two. One, two, three. That means that you were watching AlphaGo. Two, three. And the commentators on AlphaGo. What did you think? You were going to be doing a thing. Yeah, well, I just broke half of this, so you didn't miss much. You missed the last minute three. Artificial creativity, I was just asking you what you thought about AlphaGo. And my regards to your family. Obviously, that comes first. Everything is fine. No, that's supposed to happen. They're on bearings. That's supposed to happen. Everything is fine. Good. Okay. So, I don't think I'm actually going to do encase the not work until we're good. Which, we are good. You don't recognize the name. Oh my word. Okay, so AlphaGo, let me link this for you. AlphaGo recently won a major Go tournament against the world champion. It won 4-1 against Lee Sedol. Critically, the commentators who described some of AlphaGo's movements used words like creative and beautiful. And so if you're looking at artificial creativity, yeah, it's really just... We live in such a weird time. Such a weird time. So yeah, Google's AlphaGo beating Lee Sedol. But I mean, so when you say that you don't really follow, oops. What do you, I mean, so this is of course the fundamental academic problem. How do you define your terms, right? How do you define what it is that you are researching? Yeah, I think when they have loops, this whole thing will be entirely doable in Scrap Mechanic. I'm so glad I didn't remove that link. That would have been tedious. That would have been really tedious. Help. Click. And click. But I like relative to so just getting back to my prior thing while you're off, I think relative to how normal Scrap Mechanic circuits go, this is obviously excluding the not work, which is just bullshit. This whole process is not that bad. And I think this would be a real competitor for complex logic in Scrap Mechanic when they have loops. Mikhail, I assume... Wait, no. Two people watching... One of those is my own stream. Mikhail is likely off to get creeps. He's only reasonable. Thank you. And I mean, even this not work is not too bad. It's not great. But if this is a copy pastable thing, yeah, I could see that. I could totally see that. It's playing in the background. Sneaky. So are you creeping? Are you creepy? All right, let's see how this works. Uh-oh. Oh dear. Okay. The reason why it's falling is because I'm an idiot. That's fine. I can totally deal with that answer. Cannot deny a man his crepes. Yes, and Mikhail makes really good crepes. Oh, right, you're chatting. You're aiming to have mechanical learning and creation of art that quantifiably... Did you see the recent Rembrandt article? That they were able to get someone, a bot to paint in the style of Rembrandt's brushstrokes portraiture. So, theoretically, if we set this to 1, and we hit the balance, that's not going to move. And that's set to 0. So that should go forward. Oh my god! Look at it! It worked! I mean, obviously, it clanked, but it worked. This is going to work, right? So you hit the center point of the balance, so that goes forward. It worked. All right. Okay, so So. Do-re-mi-so-fa. Okay, so. How do we want to do this? 1, 2, 5. So we have our clock input here. An actuated input here, and an actuated input here, and we shouldn't panic, even though we are panicking, because this is in the floor. Fine. Okay. Now, their actuators how do they show their actuators? They don't. They don't. Low disk space. Huh. Okay, well. What? You go away. Stream still working? Yes, good. Excellent. Okay, so they're not showing their actuators actuating. We're showing that this is working. Obviously, we're not doing shift registers. So, options for actuation. Option one for actuation is this, where we have a scrap mechanic linear actuator like so. And that would work. All right, let's go experiment with linear actuators. Because I think that this is a sufficiently persuasive... Oh, I panic every time. Clank. But I think that's persuasive. Let's go experiment with linear actuators. So how far can this system advance? Zero state is at one... Right? Zero is at three blocks back, or it's at zero. Womp. That looks like one block forward. But I somehow don't think that's at the limit of travel. I'm going to say two blocks forward. That we want a linear actuator that can advance the system reliably. No, three blocks forward. Yeah, because this is about a block left to travel. So we want an advance of three. Do we want this to be coupled to the system? Yes. Yes, we want this to be coupled to the system. So, therefore, if we're to advance three, then two blocks should be just fine. Yes? Because that's at one. Yes, because the math works out really neatly. The other thing I learned is connection, bearing connection matters. So one, two, three. So one and three advance to 90. And two advances negative 90. Well, that worked. Okay. That's going in the right direction. Oh, right, because that needs to be negative 180. So that's straight. So a bearing won't advance to 90 unless you tell it to advance 90. So that should go perfectly straight. Yep. And one of my, yeah, I just noticed that. So, against the ground, two, three. This should advance 2 squares or 3 squares? This advances... Yes, that is absolutely the trouble with the computers. They do precisely what we tell them to do, not what we mean, which is why I'm so terrified of AI. Because an AI will quite happily do what we tell it to do. So this is a travel of 2 squares, perfectly linear. That works. That works. And it means that we're not messing with angles like we are in that system. So, therefore, each one of these needs a perfectly linear travel and not work. No, it should work. Not that it should not work. Sorry, puns. But they're punny. I'm innocent if it's sufficiently punny, right? Arg. Why you not... Why are you not center of gravity? Because. Okay, so bearing, clock, folded up. And then standard not work. Actually, I think the opposite is now important. Ah. You go forward, and we don't mess with you. Two, bearing, 1, 2, bearing. Fine. Everything is fine. Great. So these are 1, 2, 3 linear bearings. This is input 1. This is input 0. This is the clock. We are absolutely making sure that we are following the system design rules here. Like this is, do I have a highlight? These are really important system rules, right? That the mechanism starts with all inputs set at 0, which is why it's on a lift. It cannot be attached to the world because of rule 1. One of the locks is set to 1, and then the balance is set to 1. Yeah. so now we knot this back up. Well, not back up, but speaking of which, have you taken a backup of your files lately? Given that you're in 2 master's degrees, you should have a continuous backup of your files. Specifically, you should have continuous backup of your files without needing your positive involvement of them. What? Oh, you're lower because that's lower. Fine, 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 fine. Everything is fine. Good, good, good. Because yes, Google's mandate that a file is not written to disk until it has been written to 3 data centers on 2 continents is well advised. And of course, a recovery strategy for when that fails is worthwhile. I was recently covering that with my digital humanities class, teaching them all the many ways to lose data and that excuses of data loss would not be accepted in the class. We spent a lot of time on that. I think they were suitably frightened. Which is good, because data loss is scary. And we do not do enough to teach students about how to deal with data loss. They think that having manual backups or emailing files themselves is appropriate. It is not. It does not work. Given, Lightbringer, that you're, you know, watching this, you might actually be interested in my typesetting setup. That I'm quite proud of. I use context in a continual integration environment so that all of our typesetting is done. I'm happy to detail that if you're interested, because I'm not a fan of using Word for typesetting. So, does this work? Clank. I think it works. I think it works well. Does this work? Clank. This is going to be interesting. But I think the answer... Oh, look at that. It doesn't... Uh-oh. This movement is not straightforward. Oh yeah, LaTeX is rather standard. I use Comtech, but that's just because I prefer philosophy and I do book-length stuff. Take a look at Comtech. I think it's a lot better as a macro language to tech than LaTeX is. It, of course, has its own foibles. Okay, this is out of alignment. Of course it's out of alignment. It goes in as it travels. What are you using to code in LaTeX? I can help. Yeah, having 0 stops is important. All right. I don't actually think these linear bearings are the bestest idea. Oh. Ah, so take a look at Pandoc. I'm working on. No, not that. A project with Columbia and Duke. For Markdown into Jekyll for a journal. Markdown into Tech and Jekyll for a journal. Okay, so these bearings are not appropriate. We actually need to. To break this. Yeah, none of these we can rely on as straight movement forward. And I'm missing a bearing. Great! Guess what I get to do? If your guess was undo the last 15 minutes of work, you win a prize! What prize, you ask? No. So, we need frame-coupled pushers rather than logic-coupled linear bearings, because the bearings aren't linear. Should be obvious. Poop. Poop. So, have we reset? Nope. All right, so first, you, sir, need to be on your own bearing. Because this isn't a linear system, it rotates. As it goes forward, how do we do this? How do we do this? How do we do this? So, the point of the exercise is that while this goes, well, this goes forward, this goes in, and this goes in. And this is not balanced. That's funny. Which is never something you ever want to hear. Ever. no. That's fine. But yeah, like that. Linear bearing, linear actuator on a bearing, like in their dislikes. I don't actually speak Spanish, mate, so not quite sure what you're saying there. Linear actuator on a bearing. All right, so we let's look at their lock. So, therefore, but this doesn't make sense. That shows anchored. This doesn't show the linear bearing rotating. It shows that it's offline, and we know why it's offline. Because it's been pushed in. Yeah, I looked at this diagram and I just kind of screamed. Not gonna happen. Say again, Lightbringer. The far end is a stationary pivot. The line pushes out, the pushing causes the rotation. So therefore, we want a bearing here, or do all of these. So therefore, this is not actually rigid. At all. This is. So that's there. And that's there. And these are actuated on their own beams. Is that what you're saying? I'm missing something here. This, I agree, needs to be on its own bearing. And this needs to be brought in line. because that's just bugging me. Figure six. So, as the bearing rotates around, so that line is static. So, therefore, there's a pusher line, and then there is that, and that comes back. And then as this rotates around this point, that causes rotation. Yep. So this comes back along itself. Which means that we should actually, you know, pay some attention. 1, 2, 3, 4. But this should be even, right? I actually don't think that. No, 9. It should be odd. Everything should be odd. And then this is the point that it's anchored to. 9. And 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Error. Fine. This is why we color. This is why we color. 2, 3, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. Yeah. Ah! Oh, sorry. Sorry. Hit the microphone. Yes, I'm absolutely unlikely to get a nice, clean integer amount that we need to push it. Sorry for your eardrums. Sorry. 3, 4, 5. And then this is the same pattern. Because this is free there. So this comes back along itself. Yeah. So let's have minimal knot work here. Just to demonstrate. Just to demonstrate feasibility. Yeah. So, therefore, that works. That's showing actuation. So therefore, this is forward, although it's not forward very much. Okay, what's going on? So that's zeroed. I don't think this works. I think this is too far forward. Yeah. All right. Cool. This is proceeding. This work. So we set. So we've shown that that side works. Now if we cause a force to go forward there, that's emphatically locked. Sorry. Okay. Stop. Stop it. Stop it. That's forward. I need to turn on. Can you hear the fan in the background? Because it's really warm up here. Sydney, it is the middle of autumn. You should not be this warm. So, walk that forward. I'm not sure. That is the nature of fans. Melting, so I don't actually. Alright, so, for these bearings. I think I just need to activate this. Okay. So I think we don't need paired opposite rotation. That we literally only want this bottom bearing actuated. And everything else in the system should be free to move. It's quite loud. Let me turn on. Is that better? Let's try a conservative 45. Switch is on the lift. That's fine. That's almost 90 though.
Okay. So I think that this is... It's better, but quite noticeable. Okay, well, it's better than the AC unit in this office, so... Sorry. Okay, so I think that's going to work as a... actuated thing. Yeah, that's going to work as an actuated thing. And we cannot prove it, Brian. Prove it. We cannot connect this switch to that thing because they're not on the same mechanism. And it is better than melting, yes. I don't know what's... Well, actually, no. I do know what's with this. This computer is now putting out a lot of heat, and we have a lot of computers in this office. So, okay. So, the theory is that 85 is the thing. Touching, but it doesn't seem to be forcing. Does 80, what does 80 look like? Does 80 cause, it's 80 is still touching, which means we can bring this down to 80. So, therefore, if that's on, this can be on, which means this cannot be actuated. So, that's fine. Now, can this go 80? So, hypothesis, that's at 1. Which means this cannot go forward, which means that this input should be activated when I push the button. Ooh, look at that lag. But it works. Doing its job. This is recognizably forward. Maximum energy into the system. Help. Yeah. That's a 9. Which means that if we then declock this, this over here, and then pop this. Check it out! It works! It actually legitimately works. I'm willing to say that we have achieved
balance. Yeah. So I invite questions from the audience. How can we... What further demonstrations of Figure 7 do we believe are warranted? Yes. So the question is, in order to demonstrate functionality of Figure 7, what else do we think is indicated? Because I absolutely think that this is viable. But the whole point of this having a stream is so that the audience can think so as well. So wow, that's not happy. That's too much. That is way out of true. Okay. Ah. So in state 0, they're both formed. Yep. State 0 indeed it pushes both equally. No, state 0 behaves the way we expect it to. Um, There we go. Yes. That I know. I just... We are now at the point where we actually have to knot this. So what I actually think we need to do now is to do feedback loops. No, not at first. Not. Because, yeah, that was with all of these just minimally anchored. Look. Well, of course it was going out of true. These weren't actually knotted in. They were very knotty. I am so glad people aren't here to throw things at me. So, what are you building? This may not have been the best decision. All right, so. Yeah, look at that. So I don't really follow Redditing very much. Tell me about this week's design challenge. You have to build a wizard. Oh, someone was talking. You were talking about the wizard tower. What is. That mean? What's a wizard tower if it isn't climbed by giant magic rocks? Defensible. Did I get that right? That is weird class. Good state indicator. this movie.
Yeah. It means whatever the designer wants it to mean.
Yeah, fair.
Those are effective stage indicators. These are not going to be able to rotate through each other. For the bathroom challenge, the winner made a Roman bathhouse. Really? Huh. So what wizardy stuff does the tower do? I merely speak as a professional Ars Magica wizard. Professional Ars Magica. Really, Brian? So I play in an Ars Magica role-playing game. And so I have quite emphatic... Ooh, the video will be up in there. Yay! This, ladies and gentlemen, is why we build on bloody lifts. The megaliths are crucial to its operation. Oh, well, if they're mystically important, then yes, of course it is. I wouldn't imagine saying otherwise. I mean, duh. So you're doing. Does the sun move? No. Sun doesn't move. Because megaliths as a day-night cycle
are super neat. So, what I'm doing right now, just to fill the air, I should probably take it next time, is linking up diagnostic switches so that we know when things are rotating. Advanced. Yep. Actually, you should be able to do that with a well. So the way the ancient Greeks proved that the world was round, the whole flat Earth is actually a fairly modern thing, was looking at shadows and wells. There's all sorts of fun things. All right, so if we advance here, with both sides being zero, the center activates. Ooh, the lag. Ah, so that is correct. This is not. So is this correct? That if, what are the assumptions of the system? Ah, yes. Either the lock 0 input or the lock 1 input, but never both, must be set to 1. So, 1. The mechanism starts with all inputs set at 0. Check. Either the lock input side 0 is set to 1, or the lock 1 input is set to 1. Yes, so this is indeed the correct response, right? Because the center locks are not locked, these don't rotate. But if that's locked, then purple should lock. That we're getting logic writing. Now, if we advance these actuators. Oh my god, look at the lag. That's fine.
Why are you... what happened to my stream? My stream live? Can you test? Can you see me? Seems to be fine. Okay, so therefore, it's just the playback is a bit wonky. Alright. So, specifically, because red is not a listed output, right? So that when we're pushing forward, we only care about the balance bits. Let's just read this out loud. Universal combinatorial logic. Although the previous example could be thought of as performing simple logic, it is perhaps more useful for routing data. The mechanism in Figure 7 cannot provide all the logic necessary for a complete computational system. However, it is possible to create all necessary logic using nothing but locks and balances and a few extra links and rotary joints to route and or copy data. Correct. Any traditional two-input logic gate, including AND, NAND, NOR, NOT, OR, XNOR, and XOR, can be created directly from the appropriate combination of locks and balances. While most of these gates are illustrated in the appendix, there is no need to address each in detail to prove that universal logic can be created using links and rotary links, because it is well known that NAND alone, if you have enough, suffices to create all necessary combinatorial logic. Okay. While substantially more complex than the previous example, the NAND gate functions on the same principle of using locks and balances to implement logic. In this example, a set of inputs are connected to a set of locks. The inputs determine which side of each lock is locked. Another input is then used to actuate a main balance, the movement of which cascades through a series of additional balances and locks, which each balance moves either its top side or its bottom side in accordance with the state of the locks. So therefore, A0 is not a 1. So A0 is high when it's off. A1 is high when it's on. B0 is high when it's off. B1 is high when it's on. I use high and low in the circuitry sense. The geometry of links that connect to the locks is not what would be optimal in an actual system, but the use of straight non-crossing lines has been favored for diagrammatic clarity. You are too kind. So
So, when A is low, A1 is low, A0 is high. Okay. Which means, having built this, we assert that we have achieved success, not excess, although we've also achieved excess, with experiment 6. Rather large experiment 6. Yes. So, we can send data through the system by turning that on and then activating the clock, which indeed activates one and only one output. Now, what I'm worried about is this behavior, right? So the fact that green goes low when I activate the clock, that's not too good. But I don't believe that that line is ever used. I don't believe that line is ever used in the XOR, which is what I was looking at in the first place. So we go to the appendix XOR. Correct. Correct. Only one output from each of the balances. Is ever used. Although I am concerned about X5 and X6. So, I have created this, and we need to create 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 more gates. So, looking at if A0 is true, that advances. Which means that X1 can never be actuated. Same for B's up. So let's do the really stupid thing. If that is true, and that is true, what happens when we push this button? There's supposed to be an earth-shattering kaboom. Where's the earth-shattering kaboom? Huh. I certainly can't complain for this working better than expected. So, the question is, can we think of a useful scrap mechanic-wise example of a NAND? A NAND is only false if both inputs are false. NAND is only false if both inputs are false. Uh-oh. Okay, I think I'm going to take a break here. Yeah, I'm going to take a break here because we have successfully done this, and I need to go to the restroom. So I'm going to stop the stream because experiment 6, experiment 110, has worked. And I need to go to the restroom. So experiment 110 has worked. Yep. So, a NAND is false only if both inputs are true. That's what I said. So, this is absolutely their gate from figure 7. I'm going to need to build 10 of these in order to get the XOR working. And the XOR is the basic interaction circuit for scrap mechanics. But considering... Oh, you should sleep soon. Well, thank you, Light. I'm glad to have had someone to chat with. 5 people are watching. Of course 5 people are watching now that I'm taking a break. Go to sleep. Thank you for the stream. I'm probably going to be streaming again after I take a short break. And deal with the messages and whatnot. Because, yeah, I want to go from experiment 6 to experiment 7. So hello to 5 of you watching. Just as an end of stream recap. Experiment 6, 110, works. It is, in fact, equivalent to figure 6. Hey, I can label these. That's just an accident, really. But, well, it's equivalent to figure 7, so. Never mind. But, so, this is a way of shunting locks input, lock and clock and balance input to outputs. No, I'm not going to be streaming
from the restroom. That's not... No. So, to wrap up this 3-hour stream, with a summary, this is Let's Scientifically Replicate Molecular Mechanical Computing Systems. I'm Brian Bolson Stanton. The authors of the paper, who are far more intelligent than I, are Merkle, Freitas, Hogg, Moore, Moses, and Riley. What I'm doing is I'm trying to proof this paper. Like, this paper is insane. Read it there. This paper is absolutely insane. It's proposing a mechanical computer as designed herein has the potential to provide 10 to the 12th gigaflops per watt, which is 10 to the 11th more efficient than conventional supercomputers, which are at 7 gigaflops per watt. So this is very much a diamond age. This is a necessary rod logic for the diamond age. As a result, I decided that it should be replicated, so I did. I'm about 7 or so hours into my replication effort. This is part 3. And so what I am demonstrating is that the lock and balance system, figure 7, works. That if I set one side to high, I can then route output along the other route. And if I set the other side to high, I can route output through this route. So, I have conclusively demonstrated, or rather, failed to falsify, right, that this reject null hypothesis, like good scientists, that this is this, and that this is indeed possible. Sorry, that this is this. And that figure 7, a balance coupled to 2 locks, performs exactly as we expect, right? Where if lock input is lock 0 is high and balance is high, output 0 is indeed output. If lock 1 is high and balance is high, output 1 is high. Oh, hi, Petra. Yes, I am. I'm going to take a break and then respond to your messages soon enough. Because I've been talking for 3 hours, I need to turn off my brain. So, in the next stream, which will probably be in about half an hour after I raid the office for some more cookies, I will then try to replicate figure 21, which is the XOR gate. And since we can detect if A is high, or if B is high, how do you do that? Wait, Petra, how many accounts are you watching me on? Oh well, I'm going to pretend that you're 2 people. It makes me happier. I think I can improve on this door so that it is input aware. Is that true? Well, X5 says that if either B1 is high or A1 is high, okay. Is this level of complexity really necessary? Wait. So, 3 of you, Petra, are watching me. Oh well. My brain's putting. I'm going to try to replicate this diagram as it's shown, because that will show that an XOR is possible. I have shown that in experiment 6, the basic balance and lock mechanism works. This has been Brian Boston Stanton doing Let's Replicate Scrap Mechanic. I bid you all a very brief adieu.